Welcome back to Crystal Clear! I'm Ulrich Vox, and after nearly 7 years on the air, the Steven Universe series has concluded with the final three episodes of Future. Everything's fine, I am my monster, and the future. Now, we broke down the first episode of this hour-long event, Homeworld Bound, in a separate video, so if you're looking for a breakdown on that episode, please go check that out and then come back here. With that being said, we're gonna do all three, one video, and in case you missed my ending explained, yes, I cried. It's okay to cry, and I hope if you have been holding back tears, you get to have a good cry soon. But I'm sure we're all still very emotional, so let's not dive into that. Instead, I'm going to issue a spoiler warning. If you have not seen the final episodes of Steven Universe Future, what are you doing here? Go catch up and then come back. With all that said, let's dive in. Starting with Everything's Fine. This episode's boarding team, Amish Kumar and Maya Peterson, is a very special pairing as they were the storyboard revisionists during the original series, namely during the series' fifth season. Start together and together. We love to see it. Returning home after having very startling murdery thoughts on Homeworld in relation to one white diamond, Steven gets a phone call from Connie, whom Steven hasn't spoken to since the events of Growing Pains. Connie reaching out here is reminiscent of her concerns towards Steven and full disclosure. We even have the ringtone from that episode return, but there's also a sense of irony to their falling out during the season 5 post-wanted arc, where Connie was the one who needed space. Steven insists that everything is fine, and oh boy, just breaking down this episode is making me upsetty spaghetti all over again. Alone with his thoughts, Steven finds himself extremely overwhelmed, projecting the key moments of his week-long spiral, crashing the van, shattering Jasper, and the temptation of smashing in White Diamond's gem. Wasting no time to shut his brain off, Steven dashes to turn off the television, much like how he did in Rosebuds, running away from his problems, only to get a tragic good look at himself and his diamond eyes. Rejecting the notion that he could be something he views with such a vile, stained legacy, Steven doubles down on his identity as, well, Steven Universe. More so, the Steven Universe everyone around him knows. The Steven Universe he thinks he perpetuates throughout the galaxy. The image of Steven Universe. Staring at the painting from Pool Hopping, such a funny image should never be so terrifying, the cracks literally show as he asserts nothing is off of him at all, unleashing another deadly well in the process. If he says he's fine, maybe he'll believe it, and thus, the meltdown truly begins. On that note, the imagery of his missing sandal very much reminds me of Cookie Cat in a way, both illustrating the concept of a gem-human hybrid. Garnet, Amethyst, and Pearl confront Steven, and we witness an interaction that's very true to real life. Despite their concerns, the gems don't want to pry and feel like they're cornering Steven and forcing him to open up, because they'd rather him talk about his problems naturally, especially since their first attempt resulted in him running away for 3 days after damaging the house. When we see a struggling friend or family member, it's kind of commonly accepted for people to take their front of happiness at face value, because they insist they're fine, and of course, we'd like to believe that it's true and not escalate things even further. Steven's powers being at an all-time height, his sprint to little homeworld that almost knocks over the big donut does a fantastic job of conveying his anxiety and self-doubt being at an all-time height. He can break at any moment, his actions cause him to feel as if he's a far cry from the person he wants to be. The image of Steven Universe is dying in his mind, causing him to be on edge as he puts his best foot forward to fix everything, forcing himself to assist at little homeschool as his initial panic attack and departure was the catalyst to where he ended up. As you can imagine, bad idea. When Steven does arrive to little homeworld, the music brings back its signature theme from the movie and first episode of Future, but it's eclipsed by the pre-existing score, just one of the many ways this episode goes above and beyond to throw us into Steven's head. He can pretend everything's fine and the soundtrack will even go along with it, but it won't erase how he's really feeling, how things are actually far from normal. And one of my favorite details of this episode is that, convincing himself of this deceit, Steven's hair seemingly shifts back to normal as he hulks down ever so slightly, but instead of his usual 5 bumps, his hair sports 6. Steven interjects himself into Paradise Gardening class, with her students being Cherry Quartz, an Aquamarine, those two sure left home real fast, a Sapphire, and Volleyball, whom, because because the Crooniverse can't help but to throw in unresolved mysteries, has her left eye covered the entire duration of her screen time? Ooh, is her scar healed? We won't know, but we do see the cracks are still there to an extent, even if the actual eye area has cleared up, but upon further inspection, that just appears to be one of the flowers from her pot, but the illusion was 100% intentional. But this is a mystery worth digging into on a separate occasion. There's still content to make, y'all! Steven's hair returns to fight bumps, but this time the proportions are completely out of whack, and in an attempt to help spruce up some life in the greenhouse, a tiny droplet of Steven's spit creates dozens of plant Stevens who parade throughout Little Homeworld, declaring they're here to help. And as the homeschool gems run for their lives, Volleyball's eye is still covered by the plant. What is the point of holding this over our heads? I don't get it. I truly do not get it. Garnet is seen giving some, what I can only imagine to be, marriage counseling to two BTD residents, which is also ironic considering the one who really needs counseling lives under the same roof as her, although it is definitely not in the marriage degree. But hey, Garnet wasn't able to recognize the signs, and Ruby and Sapphire hit their own rough patch before. Huh, I suppose instead of marriage counseling, it could just be relationship counseling. It's up to you. Grass Stevens surround Garnet with their forced optimism, and Steven, now with four bumps and a pink diamond speck, plays it off as a victory. And I just love the Grass Steven who tried giving him a hug, referring to Steven as his father. A hug is clearly what Steven needed, as shown by the next episode, and a hug from essentially himself, much like how he gave Cactus Steven a hug. I wonder what impact that could have had in the moment. Switching gears over to Bismuth Forge, Yellow Pearl is seen trying on new armor as Pearl, Snowflake Obsidian, Big Spite, and Blue Pearl Observe, and unfortunately the Diamond's Pearls in their last cameo have nothing to say and thus have gone silent for the entirety of future. Their last lines being as followed in Together Alone.
Everyone, behold the daunting beauty and elegance that is Yellow Diamond! Everyone, prepare yourselves emotionally for the overpowering elegance that is Blue Diamond.
Haha, classic pearls.
Your time is up anyway.
Another detail worth mentioning is that Bismuth from this episode onward has a new voice actress. Yeah, right at the endgame. Replacing Uzo Aduba for unknown reasons, but I'll assume scheduling as she's a busy woman, Bismuth's Unleash the Light voice actress, Miriam Hyman, takes over. And honestly, you can barely tell the difference. She did a fantastic job. The pitch and inflections are just slightly different, but ultimately, it still feels like Bismuth. Bismuth refers to the armor Yellow Pearl dons as wedding armor, so I assume the events of Reunited really stuck with Bismuth to the point it redefined the armor game, or so I thought, until a Google search of wedding armor revealed this indeed is a real thing, and all the armor in the photos I've seen looked pretty identical to what Yellow Pearl is wearing. You learn something new every day. Steven attempts to assist with detailing, but a simple tap on Bismuth's anvil splits it in half. Rest in peace, old friend. And much like with the Grass Stevens, no attempt is made to rectify the problem, alongside the rest of Steven's problems. He just avoids them and moves on to the next situation, which only causes his problems to spiral even further. Jumping into a game of baseball, which again, has become a coveted sports activity among gems in Era 3, thanks to its historical significance in the events of Hit the Diamond, we have the same musical piece from that episode's montage return. Onion hits a home run, and the Heaven and Earth Beatles keep up their streak of almost dying a horrible death and every appearance before being saved by Steven, who celebrates the victory, but it's hollow, unleashing another well that creates intense collateral damage around him. In this moment, his hair once again becomes more like his mother's than anything else. Only seeing destruction and observing those around him only react in horror as he tries to keep up a positive demeanor, it makes him feel that much more displaced from the crystal gems and those who attend Little Homeschool. Further removed from those who are supposed to be following his own example, Steven returns home only to find an intervention, as Connie got an alarming video from Steven's subconscious, the fallen hero on loop, declaring he's here to help with a blank gaze, as if he's on autopilot and checked out. Steven, of course, suggests everything is fine, but Greg and Connie press on, the gems refusing to let him run away from his problems any further. This leads to the most heart-wrenching scene in the entire series for me, Steven's meltdown, revealing the things he kept secret from everyone, the hospital, his vengeful thoughts, and the shattering of Jasper. Steven playing everything off with the notion that the issues are either a normal part of growing up or resolved so they no longer matter. matter because his problems were never a big deal in the first place. Everyone else's were. And all the while, the episode's Here to Help music motif distorts further and further into a completely ominous, very uncomfortable tone. However, the darkest turn is Steven's acknowledgement of the loop he's found himself in. Inserting himself into a situation, mistakenly creating a conflict, resolving the conflict, lather, rinse, repeat. Of course, it's much more complex than that. It's not his fault. It doesn't make him a malicious person. But again, clouded judgment, resentment towards oneself, it affects the way you perceive yourself and those around you. Circling back to the beginning of the episode, Steven reaches his boiling point, acknowledging his flaws, but defining himself by those flaws, declaring himself a fraud, and pulling the final trigger, demoting himself to the title of a monster. And you know the rules. Steven's body is a reflection of how he feels, especially when that feeling is extreme. Thus, he transforms. A self-induced corruption of sorts. Next up, I Am My Monster. A title that calls back to the episode I Am My Mom, and the various monster episodes throughout the original series, Monster Buddies, and Monster Reunion. Two episodes that focus heavily on corruption. With everything Steven's going through, and feeling as if he's no better than the Diamonds, who used to oppose everything Steven stood for, of course he'd feel like a monster. Especially since the person he tries to be the exact opposite of is his mother, Pink Diamond. Steven's corruption allows the show to break the Steven perspective to the best of its ability. Granted, it uses a lot of tactics the show is prone to, focusing on characters who can either hear or see Steven. In this case, considering Steven doesn't actually speak for a duration of this episode, we're able to focus in on other characters whenever they see Steven on account of his colossal scale. Clouds permeate Beach City sky, setting the tone for the episode. Comparing the beginning's dulled color palette to the ending's bright sunny skies, it sends a clear message. Bad times are just that, times that are bad. But those bad times, those toxic thoughts that cloud up in your head, they will always pass. The sunshine is just around the corner. Sour Cream and Yellowtail are seen doing some father-son bonding as they're listening to music out in the ocean. It's so great to see how far they've come since Droppy Dad. And a bird can be seen with a banana peel on its head next to an open bag of chaps. Okay then, Vidalia is in our art studio working up a new masterpiece as colossal footsteps knock Onion out of a bucket. The Crystal Gem B team is seen cleaning up after Steven's strikeout on the baseball field. See what I did there? Dewey and Buck are spending some time together. A sign of how far their relationship has grown, everyone looks on in horror as corrupted Steven, in the form of a giant pink kaiju with a giant swollen neck, goes on a mindless path of destruction. The B team warps over to the temple, Bismuth in her own iconic wedding armor, only to learn of Steven's fate. Garnet explains in a very simple yet haunting manner the process behind Steven's current state. As long as he believes he's a monster, he'll stay one. With no time to waste, everyone springs into action, including Alexandrite for one final time, attempting to subdue Steven by blinding his eyes and restricting his neck, which establishes how the characters approach Steven. They don't want to hurt him, so they'll use as much restraint as possible, but they'll never physically harm him with flashy attacks. For those of you expecting a big epic battle, come on, it's still Steven. No need for things to get too ugly. More than ever, their tactic is Steven's go-to ultimate move, communication. Lapis, much like in her battle against Blue Diamond and Malachite's battle against Alexandrite, breaks out her water chains to hold down Steven, while the Diamonds and Spinel arrive to return to Steven his sandal, or as Spinel calls it, his foot thong, which isn't just Cartoon Network trying to throw in more of that, can we say that on television, that kicked off their 2010s renaissance, but an actual term for a piece of dancewear. And considering Spinel's crazy dance moves in Homeworld Bound, it checks out. White Diamond questions why Earth is always falling apart whenever they visit, a nod towards their sudden arrival at the end of the film, finding nothing but the wreckage of Steven and Spinel's confrontation. Blue Diamond observes that Steven is more or less corrupted, and Garnet gives the best explanation for how corruption in this brand new way was even possible.
Never mind that. We have to change him back.
As set up in Homeworld Bound, the Diamonds attempt to use their new powers on Steven to no avail. Yellow's physical alterations have no effect. Steven deflects Blue's clouds as he can't just turn to substances to feel better. Steven was actually bouncing this back at Blue, but Yellow Diamond jumped in to take the hit for some reason. Maybe she was worried that Steven's state would somehow alter the cloud and turn it into maybe a sadness cloud, but Blue Diamond can take it. She's used to that. and it causes Yellow and Spinel to be hit by the cloud, giving us a callback to Yellow Diamond's reaction to Spinel's self-deprecating joke in the movie. White Diamond attempts to get inside Steven's head and let him communicate through her, but much like how she used to behave, Steven refuses to let her in, which instead gives her something so horrifying that not only is she shooting beams out of her head, but she claims that that's no longer Steven. Another parallel to gem corruption. Unleashing a well equipped with a burst of energy shaped like his polygonal walls, Steven knocks everyone to the ground. It knocks Garnet down so hard that she unfuses back into Ruby and Sapphire. For comparison's sake, Blue Diamond's radiated path of kinesis and reunited didn't even unfuse Garnet. Think about that. An ability with a lingering effect didn't tear Garnet apart, but blowback from Steven did the trick. And that's something worth noting from corrupted Steven, or Kaiju Steven, or Monster Steven, whatever you want to call him. This seems to take after a lot of tropes in anime, mainly those dealing with some kind of inner darkness. Naruto probably being the most popular example, but the strength of Steven's powers, as we can see, even the diamonds don't stand a chance. I think this is more than just Pink Diamond being a powerful gem, but due to the fact that Steven is one of a kind. He's a hybrid. And typically in fiction, again, really found in shonen anime, hybrid characters tend to be stronger than those they originate from. Gohan from Dragon Ball being a fantastic example, who had a similar arc of a Super Saiyan 2 transformation that is very comparable to Steven in Fragments. And Gohan also has a dangerous transformation that can transform him into a giant ape. But that's an innate ability to the Saiyan race as a whole, not just Gohan as a half-human, half-Saiyan hybrid. Still, giant monster transformation? Anime is f***. Not to mention, a lot of corrupted Steven clearly took after Godzilla. Steven's a movie buff. Of course his inner darkness would have respect for the masters. But as all hope seems lost, Earth's silent protector makes its move. The Cluster. Alerted by Kaiju Steven's gigantic footsteps, the Cluster quickly recognizes the monster as Steven, which is conveyed through it only showing restraint, holding Steven back with a strong hold. Considering the first thing the Cluster did to Yellow Diamond's ship was not get halfway across the ocean, I think this is a very safe deduction. Greg also makes a very important stance, refusing to leave his son's side as he always runs away or remains absent for the most essential important gem business. He was absent for a lot of the traumatizing moments in Steven's life. This paves way for everyone to take responsibility for their neglect and damage that contributed to Steven's mental health. Greg was absent in moments where Steven could have needed him the most. The Diamonds blame themselves for their actions throughout the original series, Spinel blames her intent to kill during the events of the movie, and White Diamond acknowledges how everything really comes back to her. That Pink Diamond was only the product of White's rules and instruction. White Diamond hurt Yellow and Blue and Pink. They all hurt each other. White Diamond, despite her tendency to make everything about her, even in this moment, finally takes accountability for everything she's done, even acknowledging how her orders led to irreversible damage to the entire universe. Channeling her inner Steven, much like in the new Crystal Gems, Connie points out that this isn't the time for everyone to beat themselves up, that they need to be here for Steven and provide the support he always aided for everyone else. A calmer rendition of True Kind of Love carrying this monologue, which reignites the fire within Garnet to come back together with a solid plan, instructing Yellow to make her a giant woman and for Blue Diamond to lift everyone else up. See, those new powers came in handy. Steven's family charges Adam with love. And notice that Paradise has come a very long way of her metal powers in relation to Bismuth's armor, as now she doesn't even need a trash can, using Bismuth as a vehicle as she lifts her through the sky. Holding down Steven with a big old hug, everyone relays that they're here for Steven, no matter what happened in the past, no matter what happens in the future. Greg tells Steven whatever he needs, he'll make it happen, which is likely how Steven affords moving out of the state and therapy. Paradox confides that she'll never give up on Steven, just like how he never gave up on her, for a reason she still doesn't understand. Which really, more than anything, really cements that alien character within Paradox. Amethyst reflects on how she used to hate herself, one of the most prominent arcs in the third season, and how it's possible for Steven to truly love himself. Pearl relates her repressed identity and past as Pink Diamond's servant, informing Steven that he shouldn't have to hide any part of himself, no matter how bad he's feeling, or how scared he is to show everyone that side. And Connie seals the deal with a healing kiss of her own. Steven, moved to absolute tears, finally lets it all out as he lets everyone else in. His healing properties and the support of his family returning him back to normal. Steven comes to, finally reflecting who he truly is once more, as Lion greets them with a slobbery welcome back kiss. A lick that I can only imagine served as one of the biggest wake-up calls to Steven. Despite him at his worst, Lion still gives him the same kisses he received as a child. Steven thought he was far removed from the kid he used to be, but Lion's familiar love, after everything Steven's done and been through, reminds Steven that he's, well, still Steven. He's still the kid he used to be. He's not a fraud. Pets are a very powerful thing. They more often than not are able to recognize what's wrong before any human being can, and they're always down to give affection. This shows Steven that he's still worthy of love, and with that, Steven can only cry and cry. And it's a cry he very much deserved. It's a cry we all deserved. Last but not least, the future. Which, I'm gonna be honest, I'm surprised I didn't see storyboarded by Rebecca Sugar alongside the other boarders, but in a way, that's more than fine. Future was an epilogue that was more given to the storyboarders. So I'm glad Sugar was able to completely entrust the final episode of her baby to two of the best boarders. But all of Future storyboards were fantastic, so am I even saying anything new? Anywho, months after Steven's spiral, we see that our boy has already made strides in his recovery, now in the swing of morning workout routines, with this routine in particular being the exact one performed by him and Garnet in Future Vision, although the equipment properly debuted in Coach Steven. Though it doesn't remain intact for long thanks to Lion, Steven and Connie flesh out Steven's upcoming road trip across all 39 states in the country. Huh, that's weird. Isn't there 11 Confederate states? Subtract that from 50 and you get, hey! That's pretty funny. Steven references visiting Sadie, Shep, and Lars on this journey of self-discovery, something Lars planted the seeds for in his final proper appearance, Little Graduation. Everyone in BCD seems to have taken the news of Steven leaving, well, pretty okay. Steven's taking Greg's advice from Mr. Universe by heading off on his own. The only people not in the loop, of course, being the Gems. He's afraid, and being someone who recently moved out of his own childhood home, this episode hit hard, especially with Steven's approach towards informing his parental guardians that he's about to become a big boy for real. Steven decides to break the news with homemade cookie cats, sporting a lopsided, runny pink eye, which could be looked at as the imagery of Cookie Cat at the beginning of the series versus now, at the end of the series. While one of his interpretations can still be Steven's human and gem half, a lot of people also brought it back to Rose Quartz and Pink Diamond, the two sides of Steven's mother. So in a way, you can look at the sloppy pink eye as the now skewed view of Rose that the gems still carry. The cookie cats paved the way for Pearl to eat for the very first time, taking a small nibble as a token of appreciation. Between this and shapeshifting back in Snow Day, Pearl is doing a great job of overcoming everything she endured under Pink Diamond's rule. A fitting bookend for the character, but speaking of bookends, the placement of Steven and the gems as they reminisce on the old times is identical to where they were standing in Gem Glow when Steven broke out the cookie cat rap. So of course the gems return the favor. Nostalgia shouldn't hurt like this. Garnet's delivery of "he left his family behind" conveys, at least to me, that her future vision probably informed her of what was coming, but of course, she has to put on a strong face. Steven shares a new perspective on Cookie Cat and the reason as to why the mascot left his family behind, that he grew as much as he could on his home planet, but in order to move forward, he had to explore somewhere new. Again, Cookie Cat and his origins are akin to Pink Diamond's story, so in a way, this isn't just Steven acknowledging his position, but his mother and her actions as well. She was repressed, abused, and neglected on homeworld. The diamonds kept her from growing as a person, yet she persevered and, despite all of her not-so-wise actions, she did ultimately grow into a better person. Even if you'd argue that Rose Quartz wasn't that much better compared to her original identity, she still grew and changed. But that's a debate for the internet to have for years and years to come. Steven breaks the news with a mouthful of information that also reveals he's begun to see a therapist. Steven needs therapy finally came to fruition after years of watching him go through it, and it could not be any more satisfying. Whereas the core crystal gems seem to have taken the news pretty well, the B team ain't doing so hot. Bismuth worrying that she did something to upset Steven and drive him away, which could be a result of I Am My Monster, and everyone's collective guilt over Steven's state. Lapis informs Steven that no matter where he goes, he can't escape himself, a strong nod to her own character arc throughout the original series, where fleeing was her middle name. Peridot laments that she won't find another Steven as good as him, another nod towards the original series, particularly how homeworld gems initially didn't connect the dots and assumed humans were classified the same way as gems are, different humans being akin to different gems, classified by name and appearance. Steven gives Peridot his vintage star shirt, a great bow to lay on top of their friendship, as Steven helped Peridot completely reinvent herself to the point where her current reformation has her decked out in stars. Lapis receives a coloring kit, as she heavily got into art over the course of the series. Steven gives Bismuth the original crystal gem flag to reflect her passion for the group. But honestly, I just couldn't help but think, as long as that rose quartz emblem is front and center, it's nothing more than a campfire. Just kidding, I know Bismuth wouldn't do him dirty like that. The little homeworld farewells don't stop there, however, as Steven also has a final encounter with Jasper, who we can assume now attends as a student. This is a great way to cap off her arc and leave the door open for potentially even more stories of her down the road if they ever want to expand the universe beyond Steven. But I do wish we just got a little bit more and saw how she came to this decision. Also, smashing through walls as an entrance and exit seems to be a callback to her flawless, massive exit hole in Earthlings. Attempting another crack at an emotional family moment with the gems and get confirmation that they actually do care that he's leaving, Steven gives Amethyst his Nintendo 64 with Golf Quest Mini equipped, the very bizarre golf JRPG from the episode Rose's Room. Pearl is playing her bass from the movie, as Steven gives her his ukulele, and Steven gives Garnet his wedding planner for Ruby and Sapphire, as Garnet is seeing hanging his laundry for one final time. Steven's gift to Greg is one that's sort of meta, trading places in life as he gives Greg his room. Does this mean the diamond base belongs to Greg as well? I wanna see this spinoff. We also see Star Decole on Steven's ceiling, as Steven and Greg share a heart-to-heart, which I feel as if calls back to Greg's space gimmick, which set him on the path to Rose and Steven, from falling in love with a gem to living with her family. Or, well, now, his family. Steven prepares to leave, giving Connie a big old mouth-to-mouth kiss. Yeah, people, we finally got it. The most assured ship won. I can't believe it. Steven begins to drive off with a slow piano rendition of Being Human. And as he gets farther away from the temple, the Dondai shifts from its hand-drawn appearance to its 3D model from Beat City Drift. I like to think this is a meta visual gag to bring the vehicle closer to its appearance in the credits, but it could have also been used for budgetary reasons. Or both. Steven reverses back to his family, prying one last time for their true emotions, somewhat similar to what Steven was going through in this entire epilogue. And the gems finally crack. Not actual gemstone cracks, just very intense crying that resonated with everyone. Embracing one last group hug, Steven has reassurance that the crystal gems will always be his family, and will always be in his life. Garnet shoots one last future vision, Amethyst gives him one last peace out, and Pearl cries. It's the biggest mood. Steven departs Beach City, passing the Big Donut, the location where it all began, only to find his friends throughout the years awaiting him with a goodbye banner. We got Petey, Larmar, Kofi, Dewey, Nanafwal, Kiki, Big Spite, Nanafwal's guards, a human and a ruby, so I guess she met her old staff halfway, Mr. Fryman, Mr. Smiley, Mr. Frowny, one last time, Ronaldo, Jane, I guess they're still together. After all these years, get on him. Barb, Blue Lace Agate, Yellowtail, Onion, who's wearing Steven's cheeseburger backpack, make it stop! And Vidalia. Steven also drives by a ruby and a jade, watermelon tourmaline, volleyball, flint, shirt, pumpkin, and her gourd family. She's alive after all. Really old though. And a few other gems alongside a townie, showing the unity of Steven's two lives finally completely becoming one, even in his absence. Departing from Beach City, the episode transitions flawlessly into the credits as the story of Steven Universe comes to a close. Guys, thank you so much for watching the Roundtable over the last 4 years. It truly means the world to me that so many of you shared your Steven Universe experience with me. And if you're wondering, what now? Well, I'm gonna be honest. I think people forgot we're capable of making other content. I know I've been doing Steven Universe since day one. It has always been my main niche, but honestly, instead of feeling as if this channel is going to crumble apart, I've never been more motivated and optimistic for the future, and I think we all should be. Don't view the end of Steven Universe as a huge loss. Look at it as a new beginning. I truly feel as if I had this obligation to Steven Universe from the very beginning. It is what put this channel on the the map. But we have so many other ideas and series, things that if you look and see, actually do well. The content that I'm most passionate about tends to be the kind that really performs the best. Steven Universe was a great blanket, a guaranteed amount of success for sure, but if this means starting over to really find out what I want to do, I'm fine with that. And honestly, I hope you guys are along for the ride, because I'm not done theory content. There's still gonna be more Steven Universe future content. Like, beyond the post-finale discussion, there's so much I still want to do. What-if scenarios, AUs, Steven Universe rewritten, but there's also other shows similar to Steven Universe with an overarching story, lore, and meaningful characters, like The Owl House, Amphibia, She-Ra. Now that the series is over, I'm sure a lot of people are gonna be migrating to these shows, and don't worry, not only do we have content up, but we're going to be making plenty of content to come. The future is bright for you and me. Knock on wood. But as always, these are just my thoughts, and I want to hear yours. What do you think? How did you feel about the Steven Universe future finale? Let us know your thoughts in the comments below, or tweet your thoughts at RoundtableVids. And for more of my own thoughts, you can find me at OstrichVox. We're also on Instagram. Help the Roundtable grow by either becoming a member of this channel or supporting us over at Patreon. Link in the description. If you enjoyed this video, please throw it a like and subscribe to the Roundtable for more great cartoon content. Thank you for watching throughout all of these years, and I hope you have an awesome day and life. Awestruck Vox, signing out.